Do that, or we can pull it up.
We are live.
So I got the presentation going on there.
Oh, okay.
Good evening, Bill. Bill, can you hear me?
I think it's on now.
Good evening, Bill.
Good evening, how are you?
Hi, thank you, how are you?
Good.
Okay, good evening, everyone. Today's Tuesday, January 24th, 2023. We're going to go ahead and start the council study session at 6 p.m. So we're going to go ahead and go on to two old business. Discussion of approval of resolution 2023-03, a resolution authorizing the mayor to contract for the re-roof of the City of Mountain Booster Station. So we've already had approved one, but they didn't come through. So we're bringing it back so we can select someone else, because we were able to find another bid. Correct?
There's a third bid added in there.
Bid added in here. So that's on page 8 through 12. And it would be the page 11 would be the new one that came through. I just had one question on that, Muddy. Since I wasn't here, do you know if they did the bid for the inside of the building as well, or was it just that top of the roof?
I think it's the inside as well. Yeah.
So if you want to look at those three again, I think that was the construction. Is that the one you're talking about?
Yeah, that's the new one.
The new one.
Yes.
And the booster
station.
Station, okay.
So that's the new bid. And if I remember correctly, I think the last one we did was in between the middle. So I think we went with the, not the lowest, but not the highest. We went with one that was around 4 to 5,000 as well.
I think.
Yeah.
It was 4,800?
45.
Yeah.
Did you get a hold of them, Marty, to see which one was available to come out?
Yes. So the first two that we got, as soon as he can come out, is in February. And then Serta was the only one that said that he could come out within the next week or so.
The next what?
Within the next week.
That'd be the 4,050 one.
Yes.
4,050.
So I just need you to let me know what y'all think.
I think it's good.
It's the
I know which one it is, but he says just the center of the building.
I thought it was the walls that...
That's what I was asking.
That we had mold on.
I think it is like somewhere in the center. I haven't been out there personally, so I don't know exactly where it's at.
So the way he worded it.
Yeah, so the way he worded it.
I thought the walls had mold or, yeah, damn.
Oh, yeah, the punch off the center of the building. Yeah, because there is, I believe there's like a hole on the top. Yeah, so there is like a little hole up there.
Yeah, so the pump valley used to be, take that pump out.
Yeah, and it never, whoever took it out never fixed it, so it's, looks like it's rotting. So that's the part that they'll probably fix. And we can ask that question again, Marty.
I'm pretty sure. We told him that there's a part in there that needed to be fixed as well, so.
Okay, and he does have it as pump house center of the building only. So it would probably just be that middle section in, inside. So just let me know which one, and then we can have Marty reach out to whoever we decide.
I think this was a good one for it. For Certic, Certic Construction, you should take this one.
That's what we used.
Is that who we used last time?
Well, we used them next door. They put a garage door in and did something in the float building over the road.
So we've used them before?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Certic.
That's Certic. So we should go ahead and go with them. They're on.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we'll go ahead and do the last bid that came in this week. So we'll go ahead and move on to B, discussion of resolution 2022-28, authorizing the mayor to sign a contract with Yakima Valley Conference of Governments for technical assistance in the amount of $12,000. That's on page 13.
This is something that you guys already passed like in December, but it didn't have the amount, so the amount's included now.
So this is the amount?
Yeah.
The amount. Okay.
Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and see if y'all have any more questions. Discussion of approval resolution 2022-22, acceptance of the Castellanos application for annexation, which is page 15 to 34. And this is the housing development, correct, Marty?
You know, it's Paradise.
Okay, and that was going to be on
High School Road.
You can see that on page 17. And I remember we did talk about if we were going to be annexing anybody in, that they would have to follow the city ordinances. Because, you know, we have that, what's going on Monroe, how we are not allowed to go in over there and say, hey, you have so many RVs that they're pulling water from one house to little RVs. Yeah, but we will now, when we annex anybody in that's coming in new, they'll have to follow the city ordinances. Mm-hmm. And so them even being on county, if I'm correct, Marty, we'll be able to let them know that there's no RVs allowed.
If they get annexed in.
If they get annexed in, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So just, that's what we're gonna, you know,
and that the other, gonna, in the other case, they need to put a new water meter, right?
Well, that's what we wanted to ask Jamin. On each of those houses, they will need an individual meter.
New houses?
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah. Yeah, if they're annexed and then they pay to connect to city utilities, mm-hmm. they will have to be just like any other house in Hampton, where they'll have to, it'll be on them to extend water main and sewer out that far to pay any impact on the city and then pay for
all the improvements necessary.
And then.
This is out on the high, it's kind of past the high school, right? This development, yeah.
We do have enough fire though for those.
We should, yeah.
We should be fine.
Yeah, especially with the new wells.
Okay.
Yeah, you're limited right now without the new wells. But the fact that you have two reservoirs gives you enough storage to kind of offset that. And then with the wells, you should be fine. The thing to look at out there is, there's a lift station serving that Catholic Charities development there. So there, to get sewer there, they're gonna have to get their sewer into that lift station. And so we'll just have to check when they submit their designs, make sure there should be capacity in the lift station, make sure there's capacity. And that's where we can help you in terms of helping you review their water and sewer plans to make sure they meet what the city wants. Because ultimately, they build it, and then the city takes it over for maintenance. And so that's usually where we help our clients with review of that, that process. And yes, to your answer to your question, they will need water meters, just like every other water service in town. Yeah, it's just a new part of town.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Any other questions for him? Mm-hmm. Marty, how many are going to be going in? Are these all individual houses, Marty?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then the city, they provided the water meters, or the customers are only to buy the water meters? He's only.
No, they buy them. We purchase them, but we get reimbursed.
And then you also can charge your GSC. So they pay a connection charge. They also pay the GFC charge, which is, I think, $4,500 per sewer connection and $3,500 per water connection. So for a total of $8,000 for the two funds. So however many houses they're putting in times $8,000 on top of their connection charges for each house. And essentially, and that was what you guys adopted, those GFCs, they're like, everybody else has already paid for all this infrastructure. Now it's their turn to help reimburse, buy in, because they're going to get to use all the infrastructure everybody else has already paid for. And so they'll be writing you guys a nice check when they get to that place.
And there's 21 homes.
21? And they're going to do them all at the same time, or are they just going to kind of?
I'm not too sure on that. I think he said he wanted to kind of have people purchase it before and see what kind of design they wanted. I'm not too sure exactly.
That's kind of what they did over there. They bought 1/6 or something like that.
Yeah.
Your GSC check for 21 homes is $168,000.
Wow.
For the water and sewer fund, at least we'll get some.
Okay.
Okay.
All righty, thank you. Any more questions for Jenny?
Any more questions?
Okay. So we'll go ahead and go on to 3, new business. Discussion of resolution 2023-01, delegating voting general membership members and alternates for YVCOG year 2023, which is on page 14. Two council members who are willing to attend meetings. And I know the last few have been on Zoom, if I'm correct. So I know Diana showed up for the last one. And we do them here at the City Hall, so you just come in and check in. And they're not more than an hour now, a little bit, maybe an hour and 10 minutes with that.
Mm-hmm.
But I know this last one was a little bit longer because they did like dinner and all that, and they kind of just put the camera on while they were, getting ready. So actually the meeting didn't start till a little bit later.
And so, what day is going to be, did you say?
It just depends.
It's usually on Wednesdays, isn't it?
Wednesdays?
I don't know.
Yeah, it's on Wednesday.
It's usually on Wednesday.
How many times do they do that a year? Do you know how many times they do
that?
Yeah,
I'm not sure.
How many times?
How many times do they do that?
Once a month.
Once a month?
Oh, it's just once a month?
Yeah, and they, I believe they're at six.
Yeah.
And you can go to them there if you want to, because there's dinner that you can eat.
I can eat a lot, huh? I can take that.
And not, you, you know, you're more than welcome to come and sit in there at the office and we can zoom in. So.
Okay.
So I just need two people, two council members.
If you're lucky, I don't want any. Sorry.
I go if you sign me in. I go for me.
You want to, Diane?
I'll go ahead and do it.
So there you go. We'll have Diana and Antonio. Go ahead and go on to B, discussion of resolution 2023-02, updating signage with the banner bank, which is on page 35. So right now it's myself and Mari who are signing checks, but we do need a third one. And so we went ahead and put Diane, since she is the pro temp mayor. And that's only if I'm not able to sign, you know, checks or anything. I know they've been bringing all the work to my house since I'm not able to be at the city hall right now. So everything's been brought. But if I'm not home and I'm at an appointment and they need it right away, Councilwoman Diane can come in and sign it.
It doesn't happen very often.
Yeah, it doesn't happen very often, but
it does happen once in a while.
When it's an emergency.
Right, like just a few days after I was home. So.
Do you have specific signatures we can see it?
So we'll go ahead and Diana will be a signer as well. Thank you. And now we're going to go ahead and go on to C, G and O to present the draft designs for the Main Street reconstruction, South Main Street overlay, and park and ride to the council and staff.
Cool. Good evening.
Good evening. Give me a second. Michelle? Sorry, Michelle's handling it from that side.
Yeah.
Michelle?
Yes.
Can you?
What's
the name? I think we're finding this. Grant Osborne, probably.
Grant Osborne's logged on. Can you add them as a panelist, please?
Okay.
Or Michael.
I just raised my hand.
I do not see anybody else logged on.
Are you on Zoom or? I can see me. It's on the Zoom.
It's on Zoom.
Oh, I got it. There we go. You're welcome.
Cool. Is that good? All right. Good evening. We've at previous council meetings, you know, I talked about the different transportation projects that were coming this year. I know we talked about the park and ride last fall a little bit and talked about the phasing and why we're waiting to do them now and how that's all come about. And we're saying, okay, we're going to come and present them to you. But we're, you know, working with a number of different agencies to try to bring something that's close to final. Present to you, but also with enough time that if there are changes, we need details, we're still doing that because ultimately we're still looking to construct these projects. So ultimately, then you get to hear from someone besides me tonight. And so Michael, Mike, and Julio from our office are our transportation team that's been working on these projects all over the last many years. And I think they've all been down and talked to you guys at some point or another. But somehow I conned them all into coming tonight. These projects tonight.
You said we got free dinner.
Yeah.
We heard otherwise.
We'll decide if they get dinner. We'll see after the presentation. I'm happy to answer questions on any of the other water projects and stuff maybe once we're done, if you guys have other questions. The one thing I want to say is, if you do have transportation project questions, they're outside the ones we're talking about tonight. Tonight's your time to ask. Because ultimately, I just go back to Ross and ask these guys, and then Commander comes back. If you have any other burning questions, I know we talked about funding for Maple, paving Maple. Now's the time when they're all here if you guys have questions. So.
Or there will not be no dinner at the next meeting. I'll bring the homemade tortillas.
There you go. Oh, there you go. Okay, we're coming. So I guess with that, Mike, it's all you.
Okay, well, I'm Mike Muskimen. I'm the second person on that screen up there, and I've been around here for a little bit. We've done some projects. I might just quickly highlight what we've done here previously. And Julio's been around for a while as well, and of course, Michael has been too. Some time ago, back in 2012, we worked on the 7th Avenue reconstruction there in front of the school. Also did some work on Boundary and South Street in 2016. 2016 was kind of a year we ripped the whole town apart in 2016, and did a few projects. And so it was kind of every couple of years we feel as though we need to be down here ripping something up. So it's coming again.
You do it all at once, it's like ripping a Band-Aid off. Right?
Also in 2016, we worked on the Safe Routes to School Improvements Project, which was the sidewalk there on South Street, and then also up on Washington. And then the B Street Improvements Project, of course, started in 2016. I think that bled over into 2017 a little bit. So three good projects there in 2016 for sure that definitely took a little bit of time and effort. Then moving on here, 2019, the City Park Sidewalk Improvements. Got through that project. And then most recently, the Washington Street Overlay Improvements Project there in 2021. So it has been, we took a year off, but we're coming at you here, I think, pretty good in this next year. Michael, you want to talk about the current project?
Sure.
This upcoming year's project.
Yep. So it's going to be, I'll say, close to a 2016 style year where we do a number of projects throughout town. Maybe we still work. Well, you might be drilling a well. So, but we're not installing large lengths of water mains. So, but there will be a number of projects that tear the town apart. Starting with the park and ride project, we'll also have a small project over on B Street for the B Street pedestrian improvements. We'll have the South Main overlay as well as the North Main reconstruction. And these are varying levels of funding and complexity, and we'll kind of go through those real quickly for you guys. Starting with the park and ride. So this is down here to the east of Main Street, south of SR22, north of South Street. There's a gravel lot there now that I believe is generally used as parking. So the city was interested in paving that and kind of beautifying the area a little bit. So that's the purpose of this project. It's a multimodal transportation improvement. And when I say multimodal, I mean parking, bus stop, and sidewalk improvements in the area. It's got a little shy of $300,000 worth of funding, and that's provided by various funding sources, actually. A little short of $200,000 from WashDOT Regional Mobility Grant, a little short of $50,000 from Yakima
Strategic Seed
Funding, Supporting Investments and Economic Development, and then $50,000 of a Complete Streets Award that's also helping funding some other things around the city. So here we are, south of SR22, north of South Street, just east of Main. It's a very visible intersection in the city for both residents and passerby buyers. So our thoughts were you really want to make this kind of an aesthetic improvement as well as a functional parking improvement for the corner. So we've kind of done both here, we believe. We got, just kind of run through the improvements, paved parking, paved bus stop, a new sidewalk, a decorative sign, which I'll show some renderings of in the next slide. Landscaping rock, again, you got some options for landscaping rock. Illuminations, so it's a small area, so there's about four light poles that'll be going in. There's actually two there now, so we're working with Pacific Power to get those located where they need to be for the parking lot, and then add a couple more on the backside to get it well lit and safe. 20 regular stalls and two ADA parking stalls will be going in. And then grass hydro seeding make the rest of the area look pretty when we're done. Just to note, this purple on the left side of the screen up here, that's actually also being constructed this summer, but it's a part of the North Main project that Julio will talk about.
Can I ask one question?
Yeah, go for it.
So how much distance is for the green beside the main street to the other side? When you get in the parking lot? It's about 300 feet?
Yeah, it's about 300 feet. I think the parking lot itself is about 165 feet total pavement width. So okay. Yeah, you're about 300 feet. I can give you an exact measurement if you need it.
So it's going to be grass before the parking, I'm correct?
Correct. Yeah, on kind of that corner that's very visible to anybody stopping at the intersection. Our thoughts were grass, kind of a decorative sign. Again, this is all as funding allows. If bids come in high, as unfortunately they have been in recent years, we may have to go back to the drawing board a little bit on the decorative sign, landscaping rock. Can we do it a little simpler? But at this point, we're looking at grass, but that is totally up to the city's discretion.
We're actually wanting grass on this site throughout the rest of the park, but where our sprinkler system, that's what we're dealing with right now.
Okay.
So
I know you were working on putting in an irrigation system, so it sounds like that.
So there's going to be another parking spot on the other side too, or just
that grass section? Okay.
I think the goal was to tie this new grass area in with the existing irrigation system, right? Mm-hmm. So yes. It would irrigate both sides, mm-hmm. and then would you get green on the corner to kind of make it look prettier?
Yeah, sorry. So. We need to really get on that liability, the sprinkler system. You know, that's something that we were trying to do this last winter and fall, trying to get the bids.
Sure.
And see.
Okay. Well, yeah, something that we need coordination on too. Okay. So.
This project does include the irrigation piping though on the west side of that, right?
Yep. So it looks like you mostly put in a new irrigation system on the east side of that lot where there's no gravel currently. There's some new piping going in there.
I'm not aware of that, so we have to look into
it. We saw aerial imagery with trenching all throughout. You can almost
see a trench. Like this line.
We saw it. So from our aerial imagery, we could see where there was trenching and it looked like it was putting an irrigation system in.
Okay.
So there may be pipes in the ground, it just has to be.
Yes, I think it's an old source in there because they used to have one. And well, irrigation.
It was just in the last couple of years that we took this aerial imagery is from our drone.
Yeah, because that used to be a park. It used to have grass at one time.
Yeah,
and it used to be nice.
This is pretty recent aerial imagery that we took with our drone, and so there may have already at least be pipes in the ground that need to be operational.
At the time that we flew our drone over that, I think this right here actually is one of the trenches, but there were several more. I don't know if you have that.
Actually, if we have
the view, a bigger one here, bigger view
on this. Not quite as well.
No. Yeah.
And then also on the sidewalk, is that going to go all the way from South Street all in front of that park, or is it going to be in front of the corner of the grass to the end of the parking lot?
Correct. For now, it's really as far as the scope of the funding for this project. It's more so the frontage of the parcel rather than a sidewalk extension all the way down to what would it be?
Six.
First street going down there. Oh, six.
Yeah, the name is street. The next, yeah.
Okay.
Sorry. So, kind of running through improvements. Are there any questions on the proposal?
One more question.
Here?
So, in the lighting, do you say you're going to talk to Pacific Power? There is no way that you guys can put like a solar panel lights in there already?
Those haven't quite made it into the street lighting realm yet. We've used solar power for other smaller lights like flashing lights or we'll talk
so
about
those lights are more stronger they can help
specific
power. Yeah,
it just takes too much power and so it will be the same kind of arrangement that you have for the rest of the street lighting in town, which I think you just pay a monthly fee for each street light that you put in. And since two of these were already existing, there's no change in the charge for those two, but you are adding two more streetlights. Usually it's about $10 a month per light, I think, is what the fee is, somewhere around that range.
Because maybe it's worth it if you guys put like a small lightings, not too high, maybe like 10 foot, 12 foot high, like nice little lamps and use the solar panels, maybe better.
Yeah. So that's certainly an option at the discretion of the city. That those would be more decorative style ones.
Yeah.
Usually that option would require the city to get a separate metered service and buy the poles. If Pacific Power owns and operates the poles, they maintain them. If the light burns out, they go fix the light. But there are options. Generally, I think the Pacific Power route is long-term cost, more cost-effective with the city. But if you have a decorative street light in mind that you would like to pursue here, we can certainly accommodate that.
Those lights, I don't even know if you can see them, but they're basically, there's two on this outside edge here, close to the highway, and then two more that are within the sidewalk outside of the bus lane here. There's a bus block in that area, so.
So it's gonna be four lights total?
Four lights.
Shining the parking spot.
Trying to, you know, keep it a well-lit area, because you want it to be a safe place for people to park their car.
Yeah, so it's not so dark and people don't get scared.
Yeah, you want it to be a safe place for people to leave their cars.
Okay.
Okay, moving on. Like I said, decorative sign. This is kind of a rendering that we've used in the past for various decorative signs, which what you're looking at on each side are actually the basalt columns that you see around here. Some people love them, some people don't, you know. It's just at the liking of the city. And then some form of a metal sign between the two. So if you have other thoughts that crop up on what you'd like the sign to look like.
Yeah. Metal's pretty nice. I've seen that. I think Sunnyside has that. I think it's Sunnyside or Grandview.
Yeah.
Yeah. That looks really nice. Yeah. I think they're just kind of rigid. Correct.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that right on that corner where people are coming through town and you see like a green area with the sign should look really a nice kind of heart of
something
town.
To you.
Yeah, heart of town.
Spot.
Yeah. Kind of get people's attention a little bit. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, doesn't the state own part of the ground to the west, to the south of the fence?
Yes, they do. And we have strategically placed our improvements kind of around the area that they own for their right of way for the highway.
And I know they own some of it, you know.
They don't actually pass the fence is not right on the edge of the right of way. The edge of the right of way actually creeps down pretty much to the corner. Yep, if you go to that corner of that
board for us, there it is.
Or here you. I don't have great laser accuracy. It kind of comes, the fence is actually up here at the top of this gravel, but the right-of-way comes kind of down to the top of the pavement.
So 20 feet away from the fence, I believe, maybe.
Yeah, it varies a little bit as the fence, as everything moves, but yeah.
So how soon will all this start?
We're getting there. We're looking to get this one out in February.
Oh, gosh.
So construction wouldn't be occurring until we get it under contract and the contractor out here. Probably start around April. Yeah. Decorative sign, again, another decision for you guys to make, landscaping rock. There's plenty of options, I'm sure, that you guys are aware of. And they all come at varying price tags. And I can zoom in on any of these specific ones if you want to kind of jump through them. But
I like the coin rock.
that's for scale.
Got a lot of dollar signs next to it.
Really, for as far as cost effective, we typically see the basalt chip or the 2-inch round, but you can even go up to the Montana Rainbow, which you can see has the $4 sign. It's just meant to give you a little.
The question, I think the main question is if the city workers are taking care of that area. So I guess we need a big, large basalt rock so they can blow everything away and the rocks stay in the same place.
Sure.
With the blower.
Yeah.
So we keep it, you know, we keep the rock. When they clean it, you know, with the blower, they can blow and clean everything out of there.
Yeah, that's true.
So we'll just assume the simple basalt chip then for that? Or you want?
Yeah, but I don't know. What size do you guys offer? Inch and a quarter, 2-inch, or?
Well, and these are not your only options. There's plenty of different rock options out there, but
yeah.
That's true.
Yeah.
You said when they use the four rounds,
nice.
Yes.
That one doesn't. Well, depends what everybody decides.
I think, don't we have that right now in the off of Washington right now in the areas that they. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Where they did the streets, those streets are awful. I don't know who's like, yeah. You have to literally kind of move over a little bit for the other car to come through. And I think that, I don't know, that was bad how they they just came out so far on those.
And the curbs, yeah.
Yeah.
They come out really, really a lot.
Mm-hmm. But is there gravel?
I think there is gravel in those, isn't there?
A little
round, And I believe it's that.
Yeah, it looks like a fine, like medium inch, 1 inch or 3/4 inch.
You can see the quarter. See the quarter there for kind of an example of the size.
I don't recall going in as part of the project. It may have been something that came in after the project.
Yeah. Sure. But ultimately, you know, these are, we wanted to kind of present these options. I'm really looking for input tonight from you guys on what you want.
Lot of it, that river rock.
Yeah.
The kind of rounded stuff.
That's a good option.
You know something? Right now, the river rock is expensive.
More than the other?
You know, sometimes.
Is the river real close?
Yeah. Don't worry about the rock. We're just gonna go to the river.
No, but I think depends how many yards you guys need, maybe 5 or 6 yards that landscape rock is.
Sure.
Yeah, maybe like $400 or $500. It's about $60 a yard in the big rock, the soft rock. Mm-hmm. The little ones, you're talking about $48, $50 too on the rain rock, the river rock.
So is there a preference for a round versus more angular, or what are the thoughts?
I think
the
round is nice.
The round is nice?
The round is nice.
Okay.
I think it is.
Let's go with the round rock, with the river rock.
I like the round one and the one on the bottom, the autumn gold. Okay. That one's pretty too, but.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Between the round and the sunset, those are both nice.
Now, what is this rock and a gold, basically?
Yeah, so there is two locations on the project where this will end up. You can see where it calls out landscaping rock. There's some area right there at the start and the stop of the bus stop.
That's a little island.
And then actually up where that illumination call out starts, that's a stormwater swale. So stormwater will shed off into there. That can be decorative rock, and then again also around the sign. And there are plenty of round cost effective options that we can specify if that's. That's the direction you guys
like. Get bigger ones. You can get 4 to 6 or 4 to 8 inch quarry spalls for
something that the kid can't throw.
Yeah,
it's harder.
Hard.
They'll do more damage if they do.
I was going to say, if it's bigger, they'll hit it.
Your chief may have some thoughts on that.
I think they're wrong. Yes.
So I guess you guys have consensus on that, on what you. I mean, this is the reason we ask now is because when we get into construction. If you don't like the rock we put out, we're going to say, remember when you guys picked it?
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I think the round would be nice.
Okay, if everyone like round.
You like the round?
Well, no, that one that worked for the guys then when they're falling in. Yeah.
That's the question. Maybe the river rock for the drain rock, if it's so small, maybe like a pig gravel, it's going to be so small and they're going to blow away.
What our managers typically prefer, right?
The 2 inch round is not likely to blow away. It's not too bad for.
Yeah, the 2 inches is good.
Yeah. It's not too bad for catching debris either.
The 2 inch round, I know which one they're talking about.
Sometimes the larger angular rock, if it's bigger than the stuff that we have shown here, it will collect a lot of leaves and other stuff in that.
Little gaps.
It is nicer from the perspective of not being something that the people aren't going to pick up and throw, but the. But it does tend to collect a lot of debris. Mm-hmm. It takes a bit to clean it up.
I think the round is nice, but.
Okay.
Cool.
Let's go with the round river rock.
So I'm done. I'm done talking park and ride. Any questions on park and ride? Go through the B Street pedestrian improvements. Quickly, then turn it back over to Mike.
I think everything looks good.
All right.
We're excited.
Sounds good. B Street crossing improvements. This is actually kind of leftover funding from also some money that I was got. Received for the park and ride. And really, it's a fairly simple project. Just simply consists of installing a rapid rectangular flashing beacon system. It's a push button system for pedestrians to cross the road.
Yeah.
You've probably seen them in bigger cities that you drive through. Really just enhances the pedestrian visibility as they're looking across the road.
And this is a solar powered option. We have a solar pad on it. And these don't require nearly as much power, so we can go that way. But it's got these two lights here that will rapidly strobe back and forth when it's activated by a pedestrian for 15 or 30 seconds. You've got some choices there on the length of time that it takes.
It's going to go on East Street?
Fifth and B. Yep, we got to zoom in here. Like I said, funding is $25,000 of TIB. This is the rest of that TIB Complete Streets Award. You got 50 for the bus stop at the parking ride and 25 for this over on B Street. So here we are at 5th and B Street. This was probably shortly after B Street was finished back in 2017. And we're looking at putting them on the high school side of the crossing. As funding allows, you may be able to get them on all four corners of the crossing, but with $25,000, we'll just have to see how the bids go. Questions on that?
That's nice.
All right, I'll turn it back over to Mike.
Okay, another project that you have funding for is the South Main Street Overlay Project, and that runs from South Street, the end of the North project, South Street down to Maple Street. And it is a grind and overlay project or pavement rehabilitation project. So its primary purpose is to rehabilitate the roadway there and between the existing curb lines. But as part of that, we also need to do curb ramp replacements and make sure that those are ADA compliant, which right now a number of those are not. So they're older ramps that just don't meet that compliance. It's going to be a 2-inch grind and overlay, and unlike on Washington Avenue, we did something there, or Washington Street did the same thing, where we ground out at the edges of the travel lanes and couldn't get all the way out to the curb lines. This time we do have money to go all the way out to the curb lines, so we get all the way out to there and replace 2 inches. There's about $400,000. That money is coming from the Transportation Improvement Board as well. I believe it's 100% grant. Here's the project in a little bit more detail. I know it's really hard to see this. We do have some more blown up images that we can show, so I won't spend too much time on this. But for the most part, the project consists of replacing, you know, we'll pave obviously all the way from South Street down to Maple, and it will get the four corners of each of the intersections at Maple, Pine Street, and Cedar Street, all of the curb ramps there will be replaced. The sidewalk in between those, though, will not be replaced. It's just the limitation of the funding. So the curb ramps at Rose and Fern have already been replaced as part of the city park sidewalks project. So that's why those are not included in this project. It also includes some subgrade repair, which is areas where we do find the roadway is a little bit more deteriorated. We'll just dig that out a little bit deeper, and we'll replace the base rock underneath that, and those will be 4 or 8 foot wide, generally strips of pavement that rebuilds the entire roadway, and then we'll overlay over the whole thing so you won't even see those seams. So the grinded overlay part of that. Oops, got a little crazy there with the button. And of course the ADA curb ramps that are shown there. They're pretty hard to see here, but we'll, if you want to see this in more detail, this is kind of a fairly straightforward project. The ramps themselves are going to look a lot like the ones that you see there at Rose and at Fern that are there now. It'll just be kind of the same thing moving down for the next three intersections there. So, but other than that, it'll be fresh black asphalt and fresh striping.
So we have the rollouts, right? We can look at, yeah, whatnot, to, like, if you want to see it in a little bit more detail, we can spread it out there and gather around.
You want to talk a little bit about North Bay Street?
I have a question.
Yeah. Sure.
Maple Street.
Yes.
That's my street. Okay. And I've always come into council since we've moved in and wanting to know, when are they going to fix Maple Street? It is, I don't know, I think it's maybe one of the last streets that hasn't been paved, and I don't understand. Maple is paved on one side on the left, and our street on the right is not paved.
Okay, to the left on this.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, if you go down to
east,
the left.
And the east side of the street is already paved, mm-hmm, but on the, and the west side is the one is all gravel.
It's pretty messy, right?
Yeah, pretty poly.
Yeah,
it's really bad.
And so the budget is including both sides or just that one side, the one in the,
this is project, on the right hand side, Main Street.
It's just Main
this
Street.
This project is just Main Street.
Okay, but at the next project for Maple is gonna be, they're talking about remove the other one, the old one, or just
Is there any funding for Maple is what I want to know.
So it's very difficult to get funding for gravel streets to pave them in the state of Washington. It's just not something that the funding agencies that are around generally will provide. And usually the reason is because they expect the developer at the time that the houses go in to pave the streets. That's your standard, which I think those 20 some houses you guys were talking about, they will also need to pave those streets and again construct the streets that are up to the city standard. Unfortunately, at the time that those houses were platted and brought into the city, they likely were not required to pave that side of the street. So ultimately that now has been accepted by the city as the street, and so the city gets the responsibility of trying to figure out how to pave that street. The typical funding sources that you would go to do a street, Transportation Improvement Board, who's contributing quite a bit to your other projects, those streets are, unfortunately, gravel streets are just flat out not eligible for their funding. And then also the FHWA funding that you were going to use on North Main, it actually could pay for that, but unfortunately it has to be on what they consider a highway classified street, or which are your major arterials. Main Street is one of them. Washington is one of them. I don't know if you have any others. Oh, Boundary is as well. But outside of those streets, you can't use that funding.
On Maple, where they have it paved, those are all old homes. So, I mean, that was done way after those homes were built.
You always have the option as a city to use city funds to pave the street. It's just that unfortunately coming up with outside funding from somewhere other than the city to do it is likely not an option. At least it's not with those two agencies. And there really hasn't been any other call for calls from other agencies, because we do check that. If ever there is a funding program that's going to pay for gravel streets, believe me, we're gonna be applying for a lot of funding. But so certainly, I think your options are, basically to use city funds for it.
And we're just not doing the street. We're doing Maple. I don't know. Well, you all need to drive down that street to really. It's well, bad.
And that's where a lot of the funding you have is for specific projects, mm-hmm. right? But there are a few other. I mean, they use city funds, but right. There are a few other routes like the ARPA we talked about, the ULID.
Right. There's of course. You as homeowners can all band together and form a local improvement district, and it basically the cost of that would come back to the homeowners then to pave the street. And in that case, what we would suggest doing is, once you've essentially turned the street black, no matter how primitive of a black it is, as far as if it's 2 to 3 inches of fresh asphalt, or if it's just what they call a double shot bituminous surface treatment, or BST treatment, which is similar like to the chip seals that you'll probably see. They're a little bit rougher road, but once you've turned the street, you've actually paved it with a BST like that, then it does become eligible for TIB funding. So our recommendation is proceed with doing a double shot BST of the roadway, which is about a third the cost of paving it, and then go back to TIB after it's gotten to the point where you need to do further maintenance, and they would pay to reconstruct it at that point. So, but unfortunately that first cost is going to have to come back to the city or potentially to the homeowners. So it's the local improvement district process. That street would be eligible to use your transportation benefit district funds for, because I do believe you have a TBD here in town, correct? So $20 license tabs or
you can use that money to do
that work on that street. That is eligible for that. So,
and potentially the county could do that, right?
The county can do
that. The county's already got some money for.
They could partner to do the work for the city, but the city would have to pay them to do it. So that's probably the cheapest way to get that work done, rather than hire a contractor, would be to partner with the county, mm-hmm. to have them grade out the roadway, put down some rock, and then do the double shot chip seal or BST on it. Essentially, kind of a long winded.
At that point, you would have a surface.
You have to do the whole.
You don't do all of it.
All of it.
Then you would have a black surface down. It would be thin. So it wouldn't last very long. If you have a surface down, then you're eligible for all the funders, because you took the first little step.
And that actually, that may actually last for a while, depending on how much truck traffic you see on it. That's the BST roads.
Our street is busy. I don't know why. It is like busy. I mean, we need a sidewalk. We have like, I think we have like 40 kids that catch the bus down our street. And they just all walk. And we don't have a single sidewalk, not on either side. It's just all gravel. It's dangerous, actually.
Sidewalk funding is a little bit different than the street funding itself. There are some other programs that potentially could pay you for sidewalks there. But I'll tell you, the challenge will be that you just have residential houses there and no other commercial drivers or what they call pedestrian generators that are going to encourage people to walk there other than the houses themselves. So, but you're certainly eligible to chase after that funding, and we can certainly work on some applications for you for that part of it. But yeah, the paving of the roadway itself is the difficult part.
Yeah, we do need sidewalks for the kids. So, okay. Well, thank you. That was a lot of information.
Not Maple Street, like it borders that city limit, but it, the county. Does that make a difference?
It's half. I'm on city.
I don't know if it's half or you go to the edge of the road.
Yeah, the neighbors are in front of us are county and we're city.
So the side that got done, that's county?
No, the on that side.
On the other end.
The long one. Okay, yeah.
All the more reason to work with the county, I think, to address improving the street. And especially from the perspective of them, you know, partnering with the city to do the work in sort of a, we'll call it a reduced cost, but it's at their cost to do it. They just have the forces to be able to do that kind of work. And every year they do a number of chip seals on their own roadways to where they, you know, if they're in the area, it's a good time to work with them to do that. And I think, didn't we apply for it? So you also have some funds to partner with the county to do chip seals on other streets. Just don't leave that one because it was not.
It's not paved.
Again, it's not paved.
So that means that they potentially already have the grant funding to have them in town and other work. And so you could expand your scope with them and pay a little bit of additional money to have them do that while they're in town.
So,
yeah. That could be a great option.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, we totally feel your pain.
Yeah.
So that's what we're trying to figure out. You know, it's like, which funding hole, which funding hole can we put, you know, round peg and round hole, but to try to plug it in and make stuff happen.
Okay. Yeah. We'll look into it because it is half county and half city. So
then when the county pay, you know, essentially say, look, we'll do our side, you do your side. Or we'll pay for
potentially, yeah.
You do it all. We'll pay you for perhaps in the city, and you guys are doing.
Yeah, potentially. We start with that discussion.
Yeah,
We can talk more of it another day. Take up all your time here, but
yeah,
Let's on the North Main here real quick. Leo can answer more specific questions. So North Main runs from Washington down to South Street. So it includes the railroad tracks and includes railroad tracks and coming up to both sides of SR 22 there. It is includes roadway and pedestrian improvements. It's a full reconstruction of the roadway and sidewalks, basically. It includes sidewalk and crossing upgrades, particularly a crossing upgrade on the west side of the railroad tracks, because there is not a crossing. Yeah, but there will be when we're finished. And we're working with the railroad right now to determine and get a permit for that. Actually, we're waiting on a couple of things. We'll elaborate on that in a second. This also does include bulb outs, which are similar to what you have in Washington, but they will probably not extend as far out as what Washington does. And just FYI on that, those actually do not extend into the road. They may look like they do, but they are designed not to. So in theory, you should be able to just drive right through that. But that's the point of them, though, too. The intent is to slow traffic down.
To make it safer for kids.
To make it safer for kids, pedestrians. And allow the pedestrians to move out further within the sort of the confines of the sidewalk to be more visible to the cars as they're driving up and down the street there. They can see the pedestrians a little bit better there. And they're not hidden behind the parked cars that are on that street. So same thing applies on Main Street. You don't want your pedestrians to just dart out from behind a bunch of parked cars there. They're parked along the side of the road to where the oncoming cars can't see them. So we included the bulb outs here in this project. It also is going to include some illumination improvements. We're working with PPNL to determine exactly what we can do there. You have some challenges because you've got some existing phone and power lines that run up and down the roadway, and they have some height restrictions and clearance restrictions that you can't, we can't unfortunately just put up all new lighting all the way down through there. So it will include new storm drainage and of course the railroad crossing. We're going to realign and shift one of the crossing mechanisms there to allow for a sidewalk on the west side. It should improve your central business district access, and it's definitely going to improve the aesthetics of the whole area here. So you got about $2.6 million total funding for this project. 2.2 of that came from FHWA funding, which runs back through the county and ultimately goes a long ways down through it. But the agency that you're working with directly on that is YBCOG. YBCOG, that you guys were discussing sending a voting member to, they were a part of getting the funding for this project for you, the $2.2 million there. It's been on the books since 2013 with them, so it's been around for a while, but it is finally your turn to use the money. So you also have $350,000 roughly in TIB funds, which that funding, the COG money and the FHWA money requires a 13.5% match. The $350,000 match. This is a 100% grant funded project. Here in very small detail, we do again have blow-ups and paper copies of this that we'll leave with you, is what the project consists of. It's going to reconstruct the roadway, and you can see that B Street formerly was improved, the intersection there with the curb and sidewalks there, or those improvements in that area are not going to be part of this project. So B Street will remain open, but this piece here of Washington Street is going to be improved. We are going to realign this intersection slightly and eliminate that the concrete curb that's raised in the middle of the road. It does include parking, angle parking up and down the street in general. It will improve the North Street intersection. And then once we get to the railroad, it's going to narrow down to just two lanes there, but we'll have some gravel strips there on the side. The reason for that is that it's just cost prohibitive to expand that to a four-lane road. And you don't have the traffic, honestly, to require it across the railroad there. The project would probably be sitting here waiting another 20 years to be constructed while the railroad decided how to work on that. So it's been difficult enough to get one crossing in there. But it does
18 months for a meeting.
It does include a sidewalk on this side right here. And then once you do get down to the intersection, this is going to be reconfigured at SR22 slightly. We're going to pull this corner back just a little bit and move the stop sign back a little bit there on SR22. WashDOT is requiring that we oversize this intersection a little bit to allow large trucks to be able to make that turn without encroaching onto the other oncoming lane. And then it also does include the little bit of paving between SR22 and South Street. That'll be taken care of, as well as the sidewalk on the west side of the road that we're showing in purple earlier. So.
We're getting a makeover.
Yeah, it should be a nice improvement. Ball belts, storm drainage, this is kind of the...
Mm-hmm. On the railroad track, are they going to eliminate the old tracks that are there to the south of the main track?
We could not get them talked into doing that because I think they leased that to the businesses
train
here.
Elevator.
Whether they use that or not, they still
have... They're going to tear them down.
Yes.
Supposed to.
Yeah. And that may happen. And the BNSF may come in at a later time and take those tracks out, but we couldn't get them to do it in time for this project. So, but they had talked about it. They also would be, I think, excited about doing it. But, you know, again, the speed of the railroad is.
They make glaciers look fast.
They've been around for a while.
They're slow, but the trains go by fast.
They do. So, so what's next? The first thing we're going to do is advertise and bid the park and ride and the B Street projects. We're going to put those two together and put that out to bid at the same time. That should happen here next month in February. And we'll be back talking with you about the bid results of that and awarding the contract. Some, just FYI, some of the funds in the park and ride project do need to be expended by June 30th. So we'll be working with you to make sure that we're reimbursing the right part of that and pulling the right money in the right spot. But definitely we need to make sure that we're moving ahead with that project from that perspective. The next thing we're going to do is advertise and bid the South Main Street project. That's that overlay project we were talking about. We're going to also do that in February of this year, here just next month. We're hopeful that by putting these, and the reason why we don't necessarily want to combine these couple of projects is because there are some different funding requirements that between those projects, we can make the park and ride the V Street project work together. But adding the South Main Street project is probably going to put in some fairly onerous requirements on the South Main Street project. So the additional cost there that we don't want to incur. So we're just going to run it as a separate project. And then the same thing with the North Main Street project. It will advertise, but we're currently still waiting on the railroad permit there. And they've indicated, you know, they're going to require the city to pay for the cost of the crossing improvements, which is including the grant funds that we talked about. The one issue that we've run up against is that they are also asking for maintenance costs. We would love to tell you tonight what those maintenance costs are, but they haven't told us what they are. They're still working on their own cost estimate and have been for the last 3 months. So we keep sending them emails every week that ask for the cost, and we haven't got it yet.
So keep ignoring the emails.
When we do know that, we'll likely bring that back to the mayor to discuss and see how we want to proceed with that. But that's pretty much what we're waiting for there. Once we have that permit, we can proceed with WashDOT and getting the approval from them to advertise. Right now, we're maybe optimistically saying April 2023, but we are hoping that we get the cost back from the railroad even quicker than that. And if that happens, we'll be advertising as soon as we possibly can. The North Main Street project is kind of the longer project. We anticipate that's probably about a 4 month project. So the with the April 2023 project or construction timeline as far as putting that out to bid, you're going to be bumping right up against the end of the construction year. I think probably runs out to about September or October before that's complete. So it'd be nice if we can get that one out at that point. So sorry, we kind of almost ran out of time. We will leave larger rollouts of the Main Street project for you to look at in more detail, the house and photos and whatnot. And if things come up, we could come back and discuss it in more detail, or feel free to shoot us questions.
We roll them out.
That's your
roll
out
now. Oh, that's not
good. That's the presentation.
Thank you.
Well, I mean, you can leave them and we can look them at them. We can put them up on the wall and
cool.
Look at them. Okay.
For sure.
Thank you. Any questions? It was good though.
I figured it was you kind of waiting to do them all the projects because they're all related. The same guys working on trying to present them all at once, and you can kind of see the overall how they fit together, and you can kind of envision that whole corridor now from Washington to Maple getting improved, and the park and ride. It'll be really neat to be able to see.
Thank you.
So if nobody has any questions, we're going to go ahead and go into executive session right now. We're not going to adjourn. We're going to adjourn right now for executive session.
For how long, Mayor?
7:02. Probably for about 30 minutes. Yeah. So 7:32.
I'm back at 7:32. Okay.
If you guys have any other questions for us, we'll hang out, but if you don't,
I don't think I do.
Normally I'd stay, but if you have a 30-minute executive session, we might get a little more information.
Yeah.
We have put you guys to sleep.
Yeah, I know. Gave us a lot of